Silence. He that speaks much is much mistaken. Being receptive. Ever heard the old adage about how it's better to keep one's mouth shut and to be thought a fool than to open it and remove all doubt? That's exactly what Ben Franklin was talking about when he suggested silence as one of his 13 virtues. The idea is that, if one is talking, one is incapable of listening. If one isn't listening, then one is more than likely missing out on valuable information, and that information could be instrumental to the success of one's business. If you're spending all your time pushing your business instead of paying attention to the market, it could well be that you're overlooking a critical change that you should be aware of. Being silent is all about opening yourself up to new ideas. As you grow your business, you're bound to have a ton of ideas of your own, but these ideas are half complete. In business, no idea is complete until it goes out into the wide world of the market and competes there, for good or ill. An idea might be a good idea on paper, but not in reality, and there's just no way to know. That's why it pays to listen to what's going on around you. If you have a constant sense of what the market's like, and you're always listening for new developments, then your ideas for your business will stand a much better chance of succeeding in reality. Without new ideas, your company is going to stagnate. That's the rule for any business. Take a look at the menu of a McDonald's from the 1990s versus their menu of today. They look nothing alike. Even a business as simple as selling hamburgers has had to undergo major changes over the years in order to stay competitive. This is an especially big concern with online companies. The market changes very quickly, and anyone who's not listening is going to be at a loss for how to keep up with it. Pretty soon, they'll be left behind altogether. Don't let this happen to you. Virtua practicum, monitor your input. As the owner of a business, you must always be on top of the market in which you're competing. This is at the core of effective advertising. You must always know your audience. How will you know that audience, though, if you aren't listening to what they're saying? It's time to put in your research. Spend a day just going around and looking at ads for successful products that are in your market, or which are selling to the same demographic as you. Determine what it is that makes these ads successful by looking for what they all have in common. This is called listening to the market, and it puts you in a unique position to succeed and get ahead. Try soliciting your customer base by asking them how they found out about you and your products. Listen to what they have to say, and you can quickly figure out which of your advertising efforts are producing the most results, and which are floundering and in need of a total overhaul. As long as you're listening each and every day, receiving input about the market, you'll always have an edge. Sincerity. Honesty is the best policy. A leader needs trust. Sincerity is one of the most important qualities that any human being can have, and those goes double for a business owner. This goes triple if you're involved in advertising. People today tend to be savvy to the games and tricks of businesses and advertisers. If they're talking to someone who has something to sell, they tend to get skeptical and cynical and look for reasons to mistrust the person speaking to them. After all, they've got a profit to make, right? What do they care about the truth? A business leader who is insincere plays into cultural stereotypes and creates huge obstacles for his or herself. A good business owner needs to be a good leader. He or she needs to have the ability to organize others towards a singular goal or vision, and to get good results and hard work out of them. This isn't possible unless the employees and customers trust that person. The virtue of sincerity is the key to building that trust. People buying today are weary. They don't want to be sold to, because they've seen all the pitches and tactics. Instead, they want to be dealt with fairly and honestly, and they want to know that they can trust business owners to mean what they say and to back their products accordingly. It's not easy for a leader to inspire this sort of confidence. It can take years or even decades of concentrated effort into order to have a reputation as a trustworthy leader who means what he or she says. It can take just one bad day to undo that trust as well. This means that you must be diligent at all times to inspire confidence in yourself as a leader. Whenever you're making decisions in private, whenever you're dealing with your employees, whenever you're addressing the public, either directly or through an ad, you must be totally sincere. The people will know if you aren't. And they won't forgive you. Virtua practicum, an expert in the field. One of the reasons that sincerity is so important is because it instills confidence in people. If one is sincere, it means that one can afford to be sincere, because one is an expert and one knows what one is talking about. One of the best ways to cultivate an image of sincerity is to cultivate the image of being an expert in your field. This is actually fairly easy to do on the internet. At its core, the internet is all about information, so if you're adding to the information on the internet in a valuable way, then you can quickly cultivate a valued reputation. The blogosphere is great for this. If you can produce a blog that offers valued information in your market, and actively engage in the blogging community by sharing links and info with others, then you'll soon gain a following that will seek you out as an expert. Then, you should have no problem situating yourself as a valued seller in that same field. For example, if you're selling dental equipment, you can run a blog about the latest advancements in dental equipment. You could also go onto forums where people discuss dental equipment and answer questions that people post, freely giving up your time and valued knowledge to benefit others. In no time at all, you'll become a valued member of that forum or blog community, and word of mouth will spread, helping both your reputation and your sales. It's all about taking your talents and innate knowledge and putting them out there for others to recognize and acknowledge. Besides that, you should also cultivate sincerity in your business by pursuing transparent practices and establishing a strong sense of accountability in your corporate culture. Gradually audit and refine these qualities over time, and your reputation will only grow. Justice. Most people return small favors, acknowledge medium ones, and repay greater ones with ingratitude. Societal awareness. As a virtue, justice is about dealing fairly with other people. It's about treating people as equals and relating to them under the presumption that they are good-natured individuals with your best interests at heart until and unless they prove the case to be otherwise. Someone who is just is impartial and doesn't engage in favoritism. He or she tries to resolve matters in an objective way, putting the ideals of fairness above all else. It's difficult for any one human being to be totally and completely fair and just in all dealings, but as any baseball fan knows, that's all just part of the game. The important thing is that we try to be that way. In advertising, justice means that you represent a sense of honesty and integrity in your advertisements. Just because we follow techniques that are designed to appeal to the psychology of customers doesn't mean that we're trying to deceive or trick them. Ads should address the customer fairly, be truthful, and respect his or her intelligence. The digital age is an age of transparent operations and processes, and the customer who gets the sense that a company isn't being totally open and honest is going to take his or her business elsewhere. Moreover, this is an age of social awareness. Any company that is perceived as supporting injustice is going to be lambasted by socially conscious consumers. Look at what happened with Nike and sweatshops in the 90s. Just look at what's happening with BP right now, in regards to the Gulf oil spill. Just a few years after remaking their company image in accordance with green standards and ideology, they've now lost nearly all credibility that they once had. To be just in your business means that all your business practices and marketing techniques are fair and help to cultivate a reputation for ethical behavior, social awareness, and global justice on your part. Virtua practicum, paying what you owe. Good business is all about the fair trade. If you're a good business person, then you pay all of your debts on time, and others are glad to work with you because they know you're good for it. Obviously, your foremost obligation as a business person is to make profit, but you can't count a single penny as profit as long as you're still in debt. Make debt repayment a priority in your business, and when the time does come to grow and prosper, you'll have nothing holding you back. When it comes to advertising, you can achieve a similar sense of justice by being sure that you pay what you owe. When someone looks at an advertisement of yours or tries out your product or visits your site, they're giving you something valuable, a bit of their time. So be sure that you're fairly compensating them for that time, just as if they were your employee. Be sure that your ads enrich them in some way, even if it's through entertaining them, and that you offer valuable content on your sites. As with all the virtues listed here, continual auditing is vitally important. Just because you're paid up one month doesn't mean you will be the next. Keep a constant check on what you owe, and this doesn't just apply to finances. Keep in mind those who do you favors, even if it's something as simple as sending you a good link or putting you in touch with a potential sale. Be certain to return the favor and you'll soon gain a reputation for justice and fairness that will benefit your business greatly. Chastity. Keep your eyes wide open before marriage, half shut afterwards. Responsibility and consequences. In Ben Franklin's day, chastity was a matter of course. In general, sex was still viewed in puritanical forms and was regarded as dirty and sinful. Those reading his list of virtues today might laugh when they read about his using venery only for health or to produce offspring, but it's important not to get so caught up in a superficial reading of the virtues that one thinks one can simply disregard the virtue of chastity as an outdated enterprise. For the most part, of course, one's sex life has nothing to do with one's business or one's prowess at marketing. Those are truly concerns of a bygone era. But for Franklin, chastity was also a means to the ends of developing an honorable reputation. If there's one thing that hasn't lost its value since the days of the founding fathers, it's having a good reputation. As you read above in the summary of the life of Ben Franklin, having a good reputation enabled him not only to make fantastic advancements in publishing and advertising, but also to make a literally revolutionary use of those advancements. Franklin was able to have an impact on many aspects of society, impacts that are still being felt today. It wouldn't have been possible for him to achieve these kinds of feats and recognition if he weren't regarded by the populace as an honorable and respectable individual in the first place. This is the real lesson to take from Franklin's discussion of chastity. As a business owner, you have a great deal of responsibility. You are free to act in any number of ways in an attempt to grow your business, and people often take advantage of this. If someone feels as if their only loyalty is to profit, then they'll engage in any kind of practice they desire in order to generate that profit. It ultimately doesn't matter to them what their reputation is so long as their business grows. This is foolish in the long term, however, because no one succeeds in a vacuum for very long. Business is all about networking, and engaging in unchaste practices is a sure way to diminish the size and usefulness of one's network. The bottom line is this. If you engage in unsafe practices as far as chastity is concerned, then you have a few things to worry about. Aside from the health considerations, there's also the matter that you're certain to cultivate a reputation that isn't conducive to public trust and well regard. By the same token, if you engage in unsafe practices in your business, then that lowers the reputation of your business. If your business is known as one that squeezes people out to maximize profit, will any competent person want to work for you? If you take undue risks, will investors want to bother with you? Reputation in business is very important. By contrast, if one engages in safe practices both in life and in business, then one can generally maintain a good sense of stability. This is an important quality for a leader to have. Someone who possesses a sense of stability is of great value, and in the world of business, it's commonly seen that stability leads to wealth. The internet is still a wild frontier in many ways. Why make it any less stable than it has to be? Virtua practicum, the 80-20 rule. Chastity in the business sense is all about loyalty, as we've discussed. In building your business, you have to practice loyalty at all times. Naturally, this means that you're loyal to your customer base and your employees and that you treat them well and fairly. It also means, however, that you maintain strict loyalty to the image that you're trying to cultivate, because this will be of the greatest import in supporting your advertising efforts. Being loyal to your image means that every action you take as a corporate entity is in service to the image that you've chosen to cultivate. Be careful, however. Even Franklin admits to occasionally exercising venery for the sake of a higher value. It's entirely possible to be too loyal when it comes to matters like this. In particular, as you learn to start devoting all actions to the service of your honorable reputation, you'll find that some methods are more effective than others. This is a key principle of running a business known as the 80-20 rule. Specifically, the 80-20 rule states that in any endeavor, 80% of your results stem from 20% of your efforts. Likewise, as you work on being loyal to your image, you'll find that it's 20% of your efforts that have the biggest effect on your reputation. The same goes for your advertising initiatives. 20% of them, or just 1 in 5, will tend to be successful, whereas the other 4 in 5, the 80%, just won't generate the same kinds of results. Now, while we may be getting along just fine this way, Imagine the kind of gains that could be made by focusing on just those 20% of efforts that are generating the majority of our gains. Be loyal to this 20% of efforts above all, and your advertising chops will improve dramatically as a result. How can you determine which 20% of your efforts are the most productive? For sales tactics, it's a matter of numbers. Rank all of your tactics together with a listing of how much money they brought in and identify the tactics which account for the top 80% of that money. For more subjective measurements like improvements to your reputation, or determining which ads are the most effective, you can conduct polls of your customer base, informal polls of a sampling of your demographic as a whole, or just attempt to infer causal connections between those efforts and the subjective results that you've noticed. Ultimately, the goal of a chaste business owner is to pare out those tactics or strategies which are wasteful and unproductive. Then you can maximize efficiency and industry, and your relationship with your business will prosper as a result. Humility. A man wrapped up in himself makes a very small bundle. Socrates and Jesus. Franklin seemed to have the least to say about humility, at least in his basic list of virtues. When expounding upon its importance and how to attain, he simply made a note for himself to imitate Socrates and Jesus. It's easy to see why he would pick these two individuals to imitate if humility were his goal, because they're two of society's biggest paragons of humility and virtue as a whole. Socrates in particular was known for his humility. As a teacher in Athens, he was most famous for rebuking claims that he was the wisest man in the city, insisting that his only form of wisdom was the recognition that he knew what things he did not know, whereas most people think they know things that they really don't know. Socrates' commitment to humility may in fact have ultimately cost him his life. When he was brought before the court in Athens on charges of corrupting the youth, he refused to plead to lesser charges in order to forego the risk of the harsh penalty of death that possibly awaited him. People might be inclined to think of this as a prideful action, but for Socrates, it was a pinnacle of humility. If, he said, he were to fear death, it would be implying that he knew what was beyond death, and that it was something to be feared. Because, he insisted, he did not know what came after death, he had no reason to fear it. He was ultimately executed. Jesus, of course, is famous the world over as an avatar of compassion and virtuous behavior. His most striking feature for many, however, is his commitment to humility. Despite being, in the Christian faith, the Son of God, Jesus often lowers himself before other people, engaging in actions that many would find humiliated, such as washing the feet of visitors with a sponge and a basin of water. He also was known to keep company with the lowest members of society, including leprous outcasts and prostitutes, because he knew they needed his help the most. He never thought of himself as better than them, and instead sought to compassionately help them at all turns. Virtua practicum, self-improvement and charity. Once again, improvement in the virtue of humility is all about auditing yourself. Treat this just like Franklin would and set a week aside to focus on your humility. During this week, audit how you react to certain things that happen in your business, particularly the appearance of unexpected obstacles or successes. Is your reaction to such stimuli fundamentally arrogant or humble? You should also audit your reasons for doing the things that you do in that week. Are your motivations ultimately self-serving or humble? Here's a simple test that can help you decide. Ask yourself who benefits the most from the action in question. If the answer is you, then it's unlikely that you're behaving as humbly as you could in those circumstances. If the answer is the customer or your business as a whole, then you're probably good to go. The key thing to remember here is that improvement is a gradual process. Engage yourself openly, question your motivations and prejudices, and you will see real growth and progress as a result, in your business as well as in the rest of your life. Humility also teaches us important lessons about charity. When we have profit lying around, there's a lot we could do with it. We could spend much-needed time with our families. We could put the money back into the business in order to reap even greater profits in the future. Or, we could donate that money to charitable ends. This doesn't necessarily mean that you should donate the money directly to charity, which often goes unnoticed, but rather than you fund charitable efforts, such as using the profits to offset a sale for valued customers, or even a free giveaway in order to attract attention. The freemium business model is one of the most successful in business right now, and it basically involves giving away a valued commodity for free, in the hopes that you can charge an optional fee for access to premium content or upgraded options of some sort. This kind of promotion not only draws in a bigger audience because you're giving something away for free, but it also helps to cultivate an image as a charitable and humble person, which is what you want. That's actually a great point to end this section. In general, your practicing of the virtues in this section should always be in service of improving your image and reputation. Now, don't get the impression that you're engaging in an elaborate ruse or something. The idea isn't to deceive the customer into thinking that you're an honest and fair company to deal with, but to actually become that company. The purpose of practicing these virtues is to improve yourself, so that the things that come forth out of you will be improved as well. If you're running your business the right way, it will represent who you are as a person. Don't you want that representation to be something that you can be truly proud of? Take the time to follow Ben's example then, and pursue virtue wholeheartedly. 4. Virtues in the real world. It is a grand mistake to think of being great without goodness, and I pronounce it as certain that there was never a truly great man that was not at the same time truly virtuous. Based on the above quote, it almost seems like Ben himself anticipated that there would be those who would doubt the practical usefulness of his prescribed virtues. To be sure, there are those out there who attempt to replicate Ben's success at inventing, promoting, and advertising, but without adhering to the fundamental philosophical principles that underlie it all. They attempt to succeed without an eye for temperance, which leads to waste. They attempt to succeed without giving a mind to frugality, which bankrupts them. They attempt to succeed without justice or sincerity, which comes back to haunt them later. The long and short of it is that if we take a look at online businesses from the perspective of Franklin's virtues, a shocking pattern develops. Those that follow the virtues tend to succeed. Those that reject the virtues tend to fail. This is the case even when both businesses are utilizing similar business models and attempting to compete in the same environment. If this doesn't attest to the practical value of the virtues, then what will? As we mentioned before, a business is an extension of the owners, and if the owners aren't built on solid foundations, their businesses won't be either. Now, we're not saying that it's impossible to succeed in business without adhering to the virtues. Certainly, there are many successful advertisers, CEOs, and even billionaires who have never even heard of Franklin's virtues. That said, they are the exception. Far and away, the trend seems to be that if one is forthright and virtuous in regards to business, one will have far greater success than if one is motivated entirely by profit and capital. It pays to be good. Following are two examples of businesses that started up in the early days of the internet, and which ultimately met two very different fates. GovWorks. In 1998, Khalil Azizatuzman was working as an investor at Goldman Sachs. While most in his position would give serious consideration to staying with such a profitable company until retirement, Tuzman was shortly to walk away from that job. He did so in order to join forces with his childhood friend, Tom Herman, in a startup venture called GovWorks. GovWorks was one of many startup companies that competed for glory in the late 90s, during what was called the dot-com boom. On the one hand, it is a story of success, but on the other hand, it's a story of disastrous failure. More than anything, it's a valuable story because it represents what happens to even sound-minded business people when they fail to follow Franklin's virtues. Grand beginnings. Despite being established in 1998, at the heart of the dot-com boom, GovWorks as a company only lasted until the year 2000. That means they went from the genesis of the idea to bankruptcy in 3 years flat. But what a ride they had in the meantime. Everything seemed to be in place for their success. It was the early days of the internet when most successful startups were capitalizing on commoditizing all the new ways that the internet could update traditional services that people desired, such as retail. Bear in mind that this is when sites like eBay and Amazon first started appearing on the internet, so the soil was definitely fertile for those who knew how to correctly sell there. The idea behind GovWorks was simple at first. It would be a service that allowed municipal and city-level government organizations to work remotely with people via software connections in an effort to diminish human traffic at already overcrowded governmental departments. It was a definite need that was dying for somebody to properly address it, as can be attested to by anyone who ever had to renew their driver's licenses anytime during the 1980s or early 1990s. It was a nightmare. So GovWorks was a really good idea in theory. They had everything they needed to succeed, so why didn't they? They had the business experience, the financial experience, and the connections to borrow startup capital in the form of Tuzman. He had been working at Goldman Sachs for 5 years at this point, and had had a great deal of success while there. He handled large accounts and made several lucrative investments that secured his reputation. It was his close work with the stock market during this era, however, that sparked his desire to capitalize upon it with his own startup. At this point in time, it was commonplace for startups with some kind of relation to the new and exciting, but little understood, internet to make millions overnight. It seemed like a no-brainer. His partner, Tom Herman, had gone to high school and then college with Tuzman. Whereas Tuzman had gone into financials, Herman had taken his business degree and entered the world of computer software. There, he gained intimate knowledge of network infrastructures and team-based software development. He and Tuzman had kept in touch and always discussed how much fun it would be to one day work together, and the two of them realized that this was a good opportunity for them. It was agreed that Herman would handle the technical side of the business, while Tuzman handled the financial side. The legendary partnership was formed. Tuzman immediately quit his job at Goldman Sachs and devoted all of his efforts to generating startup capital for GovWorks. At this point in time, lenders were eager to get in on the new craze of the internet, so GovWorks was uniquely positioned to receive investment. Not only was it backed up by an experienced investor and software developer, but it was also poised to tap into a market that was recording explosive growth. Tuzman took his case directly to the offices of several investors, and after just a month of negotiations with a few of them, secured $60 million in venture capital. Work on GovWorks began in earnest. Herman began to work on the software and the website that would administrate the sales of the software, while Tuzman got into contact with political figures at the local, state, and even federal level, networking with others who he hoped would be willing to give his product a shot. At this point in time, he and Herman were getting a lot of attention because of the massive amount of investment capital they had received in just a short amount of time, and he became something of a celebrity. They were interviewed by several prominent publications and even dined with the President of the United States. The downturn. Around this time, however, the face of the internet began to shift. Giants of search like Yahoo and AltaVista began to look for new ways to retain users by adding extra services to their search engine sites. Yahoo, for example, began its famous Yahoo Financial section, while AltaVista developed the Babelfish translation tool. Soon, Yahoo added games and the portal craze was on. The new theory was that successful sites would act as portals for people to access a host of valuable services. Consequently, the idea for GovWorks grew as well. Instead of software, the duo began to envision a website that would put individuals in touch with local government administrations so that they could simply go online in order to perform routine functions like paying traffic tickets, seeing whether their number had been called for jury duty, renewing their license, and so on. This drew even more attention to GovWorks, and it was soon slated as one of the hottest new businesses online. To be certain, the potential was there for Herman and Tuzman to succeed. Tuzman had successfully generated interest in the city government of Grand Island, New York, and they were on the verge of signing a lucrative contract to adopt and support GovWorks as a tool for streamlining their customer operations and generally making life easier on people who have to conduct business with local government. In other words, a whole city was about to undergo a major administrative makeover campaign, and GovWorks was going to be at the center of it all. Meanwhile, a survey in The Economist famously showed that more than half of all people were actively looking for an online solution to their local government needs. They wanted a site like GovWorks, and were actively disappointed that it didn't yet exist in a usable form. Excitement among investors was at a fever pitch, and a documentary film crew led by the famous D.A. Pennybaker began filming Tuzman and Herman, hoping to make a feature film out of their successful breakthrough. The problem is it never happened. Infighting soon began at GovWorks and people were thrown out or voted out through underhanded tactics. Shareholders were at odds with the CEOs and investors began to withdraw their funds. As GovWorks lingered, the party invitations began to dry up, and so did the fanatical attention. Soon, the documentary crew was shooting a film about a company that was facing a dramatic and disappointing failure. In January of 2001, GovWorks was bankrupt and Tuzman and Herman sold it for a sum of $20 million. It wasn't even enough to pay back the initial investors. GovWorks and the virtues. What went wrong here? How could it be that a company that showed such promise ultimately went nowhere? How could a company that had it all suddenly fall prey to dastardly tactics that ultimately undermined the interests of CEOs and investors alike? How could a service that was in hot demand, as confirmed by one of the most respected financial publications in the country, end up result in a loss for the people involved? It just didn't make sense to many, and most view the tale as an example of how volatile the late 90s online market was. But for those who are familiar with Franklin's virtues, it becomes all too obvious why GovWorks met with failure. Let's take a look. Temperance. GovWorks grew far too quickly for its own good. It was offered the chalice and it didn't know when to stop drinking and when to refuse. Consequently, the growth of the company could not be supported by the underdeveloped foundations that had been put into place by Tuzman and Herman. Just look at the numbers. In December of 1998, GovWorks was founded with just 8 members. By the next year, that number had expanded to 30, despite the fact that the service wasn't online or in active use yet. By October of 2000, there were 70 employees, and 120 by the time they closed operations the following January. This also included a $50 million payroll. What use was it to expand so quickly if collapse was the result? Order. GovWorks lacked the sense of order that is at the heart of any successful company. Franklin advocates that everything should have its place, and that there should be a place for everything, but GovWorks didn't adhere to this principle. In fact, they never really did figure out their place in the market they were poised to dominate. This is obvious in the confusion surrounding just what GovWorks was supposed to do. Was it going to be a software developer or a portal site? Which was it? Investors were confused and so were end users who didn't know if the site was intended for them or for the people on the other side of the desk. No order and no direction either. Resolution. Just as the cultivation of one virtue leads to the growth of others, so too did the eschewing of one virtue on GovWorks' behalf lead to failing in the others as well. Because there was no sense of order regarding the company's place in the market, there was no real sense of resolution or objective. How could the founders of the company be resolute and committed to success if their models of what success was kept changing so dramatically? Without a firm plan in place, backed up by smart goals, they were destined to fail, and that's just what happened. Frugality. It bears repeating that GovWorks burned through $60 million of venture capital in just 3 years. That's the entire $60 million, and to be fair, it was more like 2 years and a few months. Even using the three-year figure, that comes to nearly $55,000 a day that the company managed to spend each day, without bringing anything else in. For a company with no real brick-and-mortar component that needed to operate almost solely in the online arena, how could such expenses possibly be justified? This is especially true when one considers that the service wasn't even up and running yet. What was all that startup capital being spent on if not starting up? Moderation. Moderation is one of Franklin, Socrates, Aristotle, and Jesus' core values, but GovWorks failed to implement this virtue into their operations. Despite the fact that the only capital they had was that invested in them by lenders hopeful to profit from the dot-com boom, Tuzman and Herman became overnight celebrities. Wild parties were staged in Silicon Valley at which they were guests of honor, and they were also the center of attention at a White House dinner where Tuzman was a hit with former President Bill Clinton. All of this, plus a documentary film crew. Restraint clearly wasn't one of the founding values of this company. Industry. Industry is all about being the most industrious, producing the most value with the least investment, and turning hard work into future profit. It requires dedicated leaders with a clear vision of what they want the future of the company to be, as well as a dedicated and committed team willing to work hard to implement and uphold the company culture and values. If everyone isn't on board, then there's no way for industry to take off. During its 3 years, GovWorks was plagued by investors pulling funds because they didn't agree with the directions being taken by the company, and by employees selling off their shares due to lack of confidence in the future. With this kind of divisiveness going on in-house, GovWorks was doomed. Cleanliness. Cleanliness as a marketing virtue demands clear and transparent practices and processes that are free from deceit, duplicity, or underhanded tactics. It's all part of establishing a receptive and open company culture that supports a reputation as an honorable enterprise when it comes to the marketing side of things. GovWorks began attracting quite a bit of negative attention during the later months of 2000 when they hired private security forces to guard their headquarters against wrathful former employees. Clearly, something was going on here that didn't reflect the transparent and accessible culture GovWorks needed in order to succeed. Tranquility. If tranquility is the ability to respond calmly and well to sudden obstacles and setbacks, GovWorks surely lacked it. The company hierarchy throughout 1999 and 2000 was plagued by infighting and constant arguments between even the CEOs. Tuzman had certain ideas about how the service should work that didn't mesh with Herman's. The software developers clashed with the marketers. No one was on the same page. Not surprisingly, there were no plans in place to deal with obstacles, and so when some were met, the people involved resorted to blaming one another and arguing. This hardly sounds like a tranquil way to run a business. Silence. The virtue of silence is all about having the ability to stop and listen to the market forces around one, to draw upon them for inspiration, and to identify needs that can and should be met. A company that knows how to be silent and listen to the market is a company that is destined to master the market. Sadly, GovWorks was not that company. Although they were able to identify the shift to portal functionality that was taking over the web, they didn't recognize this during their initial research phase. It was only after it made headlines that Yahoo and others were doing it that they changed direction. If only they had listened to the Economist survey, which plainly identified the plaintive need of the populace that they should have been focusing on from the outset. Sincerity. A business cannot be run without honesty between its officers. This should be obvious, but duplicity and backstabbing takes place every day across the business world, to the extent that businesspeople as a whole now have a reputation as a ruthless and cutthroat bunch. These tactics may be good for turning a quick buck, but it's not how one builds a solid business that's going to be around to profit for the long haul. In the documentary film about GovWorks, Startup.com, we see that Tuzman is continuously deceitful with Herman about the direction of the company, and eventually forces his old friend out through underhanded measures. Justice. A company must be run on just practices. Everyone involved must be treated fairly and be compensated fairly for their contributions in order to ensure that everyone has the initiative and incentive to work hard to improve the company's standings and future profit. Unfortunately, Herman wasn't the only one forced out at GovWorks. In the latter days of the company, several top managers and officers were forced out of their positions through shareholder votes, and were routinely not informed of what was happening until they were escorted off property. The bad press stemming from this would haunt GovWorks for the rest of its short life. Chastity. Companies, especially those founded on a partnership, rely on loyalty in order to succeed. The officers must be loyal to the company and to the vision of the company's future. The employees must be loyal to the company and the officers and be inclined to work hard to carry out the mission. The customers must have a reason to be loyal to the company and not its competitors. In order to foster this kind of loyalty, however, a company must present an image of trustworthiness and stability. GovWorks failed in this front, because anyone willing to read the newspaper at the time could see all the controversy surrounding the squeeze-outs and strange tactics going on. The company had a reputation for disloyalty before operations even really got started. Humility. It pays for strong leaders to have a sense of humility so that they don't underestimate their competitors. Remember, a false sense of security has led to many disasters throughout history, and it's the underdog who often fights hardest, because he's the hungriest. At the height of GovWorks' entrance into the market, the CEOs invited one of their biggest competitors to come and tour their facilities, as something of a publicity stunt. Many workers joked about the arrogance of this move and hoped it wouldn't affect GovWorks' position in the market. A month later, that competitor launched EasyGov.com, a competing website based on many models that should have been GovWorks' trade secrets. As we can see, in every instance that GovWorks failed, it was because of their failure to adhere to Franklin's virtues. Would the story have been written differently for them if they'd followed those virtues? What would have become of a company that did? Google. If we're going to examine an internet startup that led to successful results for everybody involved, why not look at the most successful of them all, Google? Google is continually a story of inspiration for those who hope to make money on the internet. They started off with a service that wasn't even commoditized to be sold, a search engine. They planned to support it via entirely untested systems of advertising and sponsorship. Yet in just a decade, they've grown into one of the most financially dominant corporations in the world, and also one of the most ubiquitous. Google is a very concrete example of how the internet has infiltrated and enriched all aspects of life, from the way we view the world, Google Earth, the way we find information, Google Search and Google Chrome, the way we stay in touch, Gmail, and the way we talk to each other on a daily basis, Android phones. The biggest success story. It's ironic that Google is such a major success story because the company was first founded in 1998, the same year as Tuzman and Herman founded GovWorks. As we stated, this was a time of great potential in the online sphere, and Google was smart to develop a product and service that struck right at the needs of those involved with this new frontier, the need to sort, index, and conveniently access information. Google really did revolutionize search technology. Their PageRank mechanism, which eventually received its own patent, made the acquisition of relevant and helpful search results a reality that had eluded the electronic information retrieval industry since the 1970s. Despite beginning the same year as GovWorks, Google is still around, and how? Not only are they still around, but they're currently worth just under $24 billion. Not bad for a little internet startup, eh? People who look at Google's success often think that the people who developed it must have had a great deal of funding available to them. Otherwise, how could they develop their idea so quickly and expand it in such new and novel directions? This impression, however, is totally false. When Google was first conceived, it was by two college students named Sergey Brin and Larry Page. These two met at Stanford and discussed the need for a better way to index the massive amount of data that was being appended to the World Wide Web each and every day. They hit upon advertising as a way to commoditize that service and make it profitable, and entered into business together immediately after graduation. Unlike GovWorks' astonishing $60 million upfront investment, Google's first investment came in the form of a check for $100,000. That's right, just a tenth of $1 million to begin with, and look at how much the developers of Google have been able to produce with it. Google's growth was slow but steady. They began in a garage with just a few employees, and it was several months before they moved to legitimate office space. When they did acquire the business compound they desired, they rented it for several years before putting down the money necessary to buy it outright from the landholder. In other words, while Google's expansion in the world of ideas was explosive, their financial expansion moved in very tiny increments, building up a strong foundation before spreading out. Despite having several million dollars in equity, Google didn't hold its initial public offering until 2004, at which time each of its shares was worth some $85. Of course, by 2007, those same shares were worth more than $400 apiece, and Google was on track to become the most important and innovative company in the last 100 years. Today, they've integrated so thoroughly into the dot-com culture that it's hard to imagine an internet not tended to by the many services and features of a company like Google. Perhaps that's why, in 2006, the Oxford English Dictionary added the verb Google to its listings, meaning to search for information on the internet using the Google search engine. If that's not a sign that a company's made it, then what is? Google and the virtues. So, what's responsible for Google's meteoric rise, while GovWorks faltered and crumbled? Much can be said for the business sense of Brin and Page versus that of Tuzman, but there's more to it than that. Each step of the way, Google was intentionally developed as a company based on human values and standards. Their adherence to Ben Franklin's 13 virtues is remarkable. Let's take a look. Temperance. Google exercised temperance as a company during their growth. To be sure, the Google search engine was a success almost immediately out of the gate because of the highly specific knowledge about the internet that developers Brin and Page brought to the table. It must have been quite tempting for them to expand their operations sooner. Imagine having $100,000 in startup capital and running your business out of a garage. That might not be the amazingly lucrative setup you envisioned when you first developed an internet startup idea in the heart of the dot-com boom, but it's definitely sound business practice. Nevertheless, Google grew slowly, adopting a corporate philosophy built around human values, and refrained from even becoming a public traded company until they were 6 years old. GovWorks had done that, and gone bankrupt, by their third year. Order. The virtue of order demands that one have one's affairs in order, and that one keeps separate and careful distinction of all aspects of one's business. It also demands that one have a clear business model, and that one doesn't let one's business get too bogged down by trying to move into too many directions at once. Google excels at order because they separately brand each aspect of their service, treating it as an all-new product, with unique goals and standards of success. Although everything integrates nicely and it's all brought together under the Google banner, Google Chrome, Google Maps, Gmail, and all the other aspects of Google are treated as distinct entities. A place for everything and everything in its place. Resolution. During the dot-com boom, creating an internet startup was all about having a big dream and bringing that dream to fruition. This should have fostered an environment in which ambition and lofty ideals were surpassed only by financial barriers. For some, it did, and those were the ones who succeeded. From the earliest stages of the business, Google had a succinct and powerful mission statement in place that they would index and make searchable all of the information on the World Wide Web. To be certain, they've done that. They've also lived up to their other resolutions, such as the one reflected in their corporate motto, "Don't be evil." Because such mission statements were in place early, they affected the development of Google's unique company culture, something that many view as the key to their success and the most revolutionary aspect of the company as a whole. Frugality. Frugality is one of the most important virtues a businessman can have, and Sergey Brin and Larry Page seem to have it in spades. They were both graduates of Ivy League institutions, and so it must have been very tempting to spend as if they were certain of their success. They showed admirable restraint, however, keeping operations and payroll at a bare minimum until it was absolutely necessary that they expand. The only reason they moved out of the garage was because there literally wasn't enough room for their employees. It was a step taken because the company had actually legitimately grown that large, not a step taken to create a false impression of luxury and opulence for the shareholders.
Moderation. Google's rise to success teaches important lessons about moderation as well.
As mentioned up above, their initial investment to get the company up and running was just $100,000. This was quite a bit lower than most other startups were getting from venture capitalists at the time. But look at how much more Google has done with that $100,000 compared to what others have done with hundreds of times as much. This is because Google showed moderation in their early development, using money as wisely as possible and keeping their expenses in check every step of the way.
Google ran a tight ship, and because of that, their $100,000 went a good deal further than it would have otherwise. Industry. So just what was Google doing during those early years if not going out and spending venture capital?
To put it bluntly, they were working, and hard. They were being industrious.
When Google got to the internet, search was already a big thing.
They had major competitors to go up against in the form of AltaVista, Yahoo, and the built-in search functionality of service providers like AOL. Despite that, the quality of their product was enough to first redefine the market through their PageRank mechanism and then corner it totally by 2001. They also took the all-important step of pioneering the paid-by-advertisement model that allowed them to offer their services for free and gather a wider audience than their competitors.
Cleanliness. Cleanliness in marketing is all about establishing transparent and respectable practices that develop a positive reputation for the company. Google's corporate motto, "Don't be evil," reflects this intention quite succinctly.
Frustrated by the closed-off and sometimes downright exploitative practices committed by the industrial complex in the past, Google resolved that their own business practices would not be marred by what they perceived as moral corruption, and they made that vow the center of their company culture. The result was that they grew into a company with a strong reputation for being innovative and respectable, and in touch with their audience. This good reputation now allows Google to enjoy competitive status no matter what area of the digital marketplace they choose to expand into. Look at how quickly the Android OS has emerged as a valued competitor against Apple's wildly popular iPhone platform.
Tranquility.
As a whole, Google is a company that has managed to avoid controversy.
Even during the early stages of GovWorks, Tuzman was frequently involved in spats with people in the media, and more often than not, his presence in the media was related to parties or social functions rather than his business as a whole. Whenever you saw Google mentioned in the media, it was because of what they do as a business, or how innovative their company culture was, or how great the food in the lunchroom was, and all of it free. In other words, whenever Google made news, it was always good news, and they promoted a peaceful and tranquil image overall. This served them quite well in establishing the reputation they currently enjoy. Silence. Google is the expert at lying low, staying quiet, and then jumping into action when the market suggests that a good idea is afoot. Consider one of their earliest acquisitions. While other portals and startups were rapidly expanding into any and every category they could conceive, Google was focusing on search. Then, suddenly, they announced that they had acquired the rights to 3D mapping software from a small company. Few paid attention at the time, but Google Earth became a phenomenal success that made headlines across the globe. Google may have been silent, but the media certainly wasn't silent when it came to Google. Sincerity. Sincerity in business means having open and honest lines of communication between everyone involved. Everyone must be on the same page as far as corporate values and long-term plans are concerned, so that all efforts are coordinated towards the same ultimate goals. Google has performed quite admirably in upholding this virtue over the years. Their loyalty to their employees is legendary, including a period when they insisted on retaining their uncommonly good employee benefits packages, even when shareholders suggested scaling back on them. They're also devoted to the open source movement, allowing access not only to their practices as a company, but to the very blueprints of their most successful projects. Can you imagine Henry Ford releasing the blueprints for the Model T to his competitors? But that's exactly what Google does every day. They've found other ways to make money, and this kind of thing goes a long way towards reassuring people of their sincerity in regards to not being evil. Justice. A good company must treat competitors, employees, and customers alike with a sense of fair and equal justice. It must also work to uphold virtuous practices in the marketplace and to stray away from practices that aren't just. One of the few controversies to hit Google over the years was their compliance with China's stringent internet censorship policies. For instance, if you did an image search for Tiananmen on the American Google site, you'd get the familiar and icon shot of the student standing in front of the oncoming tanks. If you searched on Google's China site, however, there would be nothing of the sort. Many viewed this implicit support of censorship as antithetical to Google's ethos, and to their credit, Google listened. They no longer support such policies, and all versions of their website allow unrestricted access to content, in the name of a free and accessible internet. Chastity. Chastity in the business context means loyalty to employees, customers, shareholders, and anyone who has a stake in the company's success. All too often, one hears about a company growing and then alienating its original customer base, resulting in a sharp loss of revenue. Google has consistently maintained a sense of loyalty over the fans, from its demonstrated loyalty to its employees and investors, and also to its customers. Google routinely solicits ideas and input from users and then responds in good faith, tweaking or altering their products in accordance with the desires of the end user. The willingness to listen to the user on the part of a company has really helped set Google apart over the years. Humility. You might think it's strange for one of the most successful companies in the history of the world to be humble. And yet, Google is exactly that. They recognize their own success, but they never flaunt it. They still work hard to refine their products, their free products, and make them the best that they can be in service to the customer. They also continuously investigate new ways in which to learn and grow as a company. At the same time, Google invests much of what they make back into the marketplace, lending financial support to promising ventures and charitable institutions. Certainly makes a more lasting impression than drinking cocktails with the president, doesn't it? The ultimate fates of GovWorks and Google differ quite dramatically. One became such a catastrophic failure that it's now used as a symbol for the entire dot-com bust that bankrupted and cut short the ambitions of many a would-be overnight millionaire. The film, Startup.com, analyses the growth and fall of the company in some detail, and would make an excellent study piece for anyone interested in how virtue plays a role in advertising and success in business. By contrast, Google is often used as a symbol of how the internet opened up new and exciting opportunities for those willing to capitalize upon them. In the recent hit film, Hot Tub Time Machine, one of the characters travels back in time and, when determining what the easiest way to make a fortune would be, decides to steal and implement Google's concept for himself. They say imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. In any case, it seems clear that Google's approach to business was more in accordance with Franklin's 13 virtues, and that each step of the way, their success can be attributed, at least in part, to those virtues. They really do make a practical difference in business, just as they did in the days of the founding fathers. 5. Conclusion: virtue is the key. If you want to be loved, love, and be lovable. Everywhere we look, there is evidence of the effectiveness of Ben Franklin's virtues in the world of business. Perhaps, at long last, the stereotype of the successful businessperson as a slick villain in a top hat with a handlebar mustache is at an end. In the borderless world of the digital future, the businessperson is redefining her image, representing not some profit-obsessed cutthroat but rather a conscientious individual who wants to achieve success in all areas of life, from internet marketing to personal virtue and integrity. Franklin's virtues aren't just a path to success, they are in many ways critical to and necessary for success. To sell yourself, you must have value. If there's one point that's been made by this book, it's that success in business and internet marketing depends heavily on selling oneself. Much is said about the anonymity of the online world, but when it gets right down to it, image and reputation are more important than ever before. You have to sell yourself. There's just one catch, however: in order to sell yourself, you have to have value. Just like any other product you would attempt to market, you can only generate real sustainable interest if there is true depth and value to the product, and the same goes for you. So how do you ensure that you, as a person, have value? Not to get too maudlin, of course, but the answer is that you gain value as a person by being a good person. When you practice the virtues represented in this book, you're not just undertaking the practical exercises to improve your marketing that we discussed above, you're also effecting real changes upon your personality and the way you relate to other people. As you undergo such changes, your efforts will naturally change and improve as well, and you'll find all of your attempts at selling yourself and your products much more effective. Others will be interested in what you're saying and what you're trying to sell, simply because you will have cultivated the type of magnetic charisma that is attributable to the best and brightest in our society. It's the same charm and flair that made Ben Franklin a success, and if you follow his virtues, you can have it as well. Franklin wrote openly about his virtues because he wanted them to effect a practical change in the world. He wanted others to look at his example and to use it if they felt it would benefit them in their lives. Now that you've read this book, you have the same wisdom that guided the multifaceted successes of one of the most influential individuals in all of history. Will you act upon them and realize your true potential not just as an internet marketer, but as a human being? We feel certain that you will, and wish you every bit of luck in your future successes. Until next time, let us part with a quote from the man who first got us started on this journey. Applause waits on success. So, what are you waiting on?